Hello?
Hello, Mr. Coombs.
Yes, it is.
How are you? It's Richard Crouse calling.
How are you?
I'm fine, thank you.
Oh, you asked me first, though. Fine.
Good. Do you have a few minutes to do a quick little phone interview with me?
I do indeed.
Oh, great. I won't take up a lot of your time because I know you're busy, and you're still shooting the show now, right?
Yeah.
Oh.
Yeah. We just started back in after a hiatus of about 7 weeks.
Wow.
Started last week and this week, and go on to the middle of May.
Wow! How many shows do you do in a week?
Four.
Wow, that's
We tape Wednesdays and Thursdays, so we do one in the morning, one in the afternoon.
That's a heavy schedule for you.
It's busy, but actually, it's the way we like it. there's a lot of pressure, but it keeps your energy up and keeps you thinking. I've had times when I've done one show in one day and. After a while, you sort of forget what you were doing.
and just lose the thought process, yeah. I guess, from one show to the next.
All right.
Well, I spoke to my brother yesterday. He lives in Nova Scotia with his wife and two kids, and I told him that I was interviewing you. Mm-hmm. And he told me, of course, that he watched the show as a young boy. I certainly watched the show as a young boy. And now his kids loved the show.
They were
just incredibly excited when I was going to be interviewing you. And it was funny, I spoke to some other people, and I do a fair amount of interviews with people, and, I'll tell them, oh, I'm interviewing, Mike Myers tomorrow, and people will say, oh, yeah, well, have fun, have a good interview with him. I told them I was interviewing you, and everybody had a question to ask Mr. Dressup, and it just seems to me that you've touched so many generations of Canadians and people all over the world. How does it make you feel now that the show's been on for 25 years or 26 years, I guess, now?
Well, it's funny. I was just talking to my daughter and saying this year, actually in the last 6 months, I've had more press and articles and interviews than, ever in such a time period before. And so it's sort of beginning to dawn on me that I'm notorious. because over the years, I never noticed it very much. It was just almost a continuation of me being myself, and it's something that I'd never planned to be doing anyway, so it wasn't the kind of a thing where I could say, well, I've reached my goal. so I just have been just doing it and doing it and doing it, and then and just lately I've realized that it has mattered or been of some importance to a lot of people, and makes me feel good.
Well, let's go way back to 1963, the year I was born, when CBC offered you and Fred Rogers a job. What was the show like that you did originally? Because it wasn't Butternut Square, and it wasn't Mr. Dressup.
No, this was before Fred, before Butternut. And I was down in Pittsburgh then, unemployed and with a new baby. And Fred had been the year before did a few shows for CBC, the new Mr. Rogers show, which was the first time he ever appeared on camera for quite a while down in Pittsburgh. He'd been doing a show on public television where he did all the puppets,
right,
and played piano off camera. And so this was a new departure for him, and CBC was interested in it. So then after that preliminary bunch of shows, they asked him to actually come up for a year and be here and do a whole series of daily shows. And Fred asked me if I'd be interested in coming along because I'd made some of the puppets that he uses, and also I was a puppeteer, and also he knew that I needed work. And being a very generous person, he called me. So we came up for that, and then when that was finished, it was the Mr. Rogers show, and it was just the way it looks now with not quite as many puppet characters, but live guests and the neighborhood of make-believe, and I did operated a few of the puppets. And then he left to go back, as was planned, to Pittsburgh, and they asked me if I'd be interested in being a character on Butternut Square. So that's really how it started.
Now, did you ever imagine that 25 or 30 years later you would still be in Canada, still doing a children's television show?
No, not in the wildest dreams. When it first started, when Butternut was planned, and we knew we were going to start taping in the fall. I remember Judith Lawrence, who did Casey and Finnegan, mm-hmm. and me, and Don Himes, who was the music man then and is now still plays piano for the show. And we were talking about, it seemed like an interesting show to do, and how lucky we were, and if we were, you know, if things went well, it ought to last 2 or 3 years. And it did. But we had no idea it was just going to keep going.
Well, what is it about Mr. Dressup? Not only has the show managed to stay on the air for so long, but also the core people, it seems to me, have been with the show, excuse me, since almost day one. I mean, certainly you've been there. Judith Lawrence was there until just recently.
Yeah.
Doug Heim still works with you. Why is it that people stay with the show?
Well, mainly because we like it. I'm sure of that. I was talking to... mentioned that to somebody who was in the studio the other day, and he said, he was a photographer, and he said, gee, you people have a lot of fun. And I said, well, yeah, it's amazing, but we all like each other a lot, so it is fun. We sort of amuse each other and amaze each other, and we all get along well. It's the greatest thing in the world, really.
Why has the show remained so popular over the last 25 years? What is it that makes Mr. Dressup special in a climate where we've seen, you know, Pee Wee's Playhouse come and go, and other children's television shows come and go and sort of peak and wane in popularity?
Yeah. Well, I think my idea of it anyway is that I think the audience, we seem very real, I think, to the audience. You know, we're not slick at all, and we do the kind of things that real people do, and we... there are rough edges on the show, so it doesn't look too slick. And there's a lot of variety, but I think that there's a certain believability that comes across that people like to relate to. And you know, where they'll watch Sesame Street because it's got some really great Muppet characters and a lot of things are happening, but it's kind of disconnected and it doesn't come across as a half hour in real time, the way our show is. Did I answer the question?
Yes, certainly.
Good.
How much of Mr. Dressup is you?
A very large part.
Yeah.
Actually, I'm glad over the years that I didn't start out wearing a wig or a false mustache or something like that, and tried to be an assumed character, because it's always, it just was Ernie Coombs with a different name.
Mm-hmm.
And what I do on the show, too, are things that I've always liked to do, in like crafts and drawing and dressing up and playing very outrageous, broad characters. So I'm just indulging myself all the time.
How do you think that Mr. Dressup and I guess children's programming in general has changed over the last 30 years?
We haven't changed much at all. Of course, Casey and Finnegan are now retired in beautiful B.C. But the basic format of the show is the same now as it always was. And the things that preschoolers enjoy haven't changed that much either. Because, you know, they're just sort of coming into their own consciousness at that young age. And their experience is just bound up in what happens at home. And even though they know what computers are now, and of course we didn't in those old days, but I think that I know that the things that we do on the show are very, very basic, and they respond to them now as they always have.
Is there still a challenge involved in doing the show for you every week?
Oh, yes.
Yeah,
yeah. I've well, such things as I've written quite a few songs that we use now and again in the show, and the other day I had to have a cue card for my own song. And, you know, the challenge was there. Try to remember it. But every show is a little bit different, and even though a lot of material is done, the subject matter is done over and over and over again, but it's always a little different way. And it's fun to go over the script the night before and look at it and say, well, I wonder how we're going to do this. And then when we actually get doing it, the puppeteers, too, are so inventive that it's a challenge to work with them. It's sort of like an improv, even though we've got complete scripts. And there's always the challenge of making the show come out on time, because when we start out, we know it's supposed to be 28 minutes. the other day, we were one. The morning show was about 4 minutes too long on dress rehearsal, and the afternoon one was 4.5 minutes light. So that means that you've got to add material, or speed up, or slow down, or do something.
Right.
So it's that. I've got about 15 minutes between dress rehearsal and taping to get makeup, change my costume, my clothes, basic clothes, remember all the changes, and then run into the studio and make it look as if it was just happening as we go along.
What's the most... Well, actually, let me skip around a little bit here. In your personal appearances, and I know you do dozens of them over the year, what do the kids ask you?
I'm trying to remember. Yeah. Usually I see them after I've done a show, so, you know, the stage show, so they'll ask about the show.
Right.
But, because there's the frequent one is, how did you get out of the TV?
Yeah.
And, it's easier to explain now because I say, well, you know, folks have a video camera, and they usually do. And I say, well, that's what you see on TV is a video of me. And they, oh, sure, that makes sense. It used to be hard in the old times to have to explain videotape and all that.
Exactly.
But that's one of the questions. And then they want to know where, usually where one of the other puppet characters is. And... or do I live here? You know, they'll come backstage and look around and say, where's your bedroom?
It's funny because I was recently on the Dini Petty show, and the son of a friend of mine watched the show, and apparently while he was watching it, he knows me, and he couldn't understand how I could be so small and be on television.
Oh, really?
Yeah, and I had to kind of, I had to try and explain it, and I was just at a loss. I had no idea what to tell him. And I thought, well, it's television. It's not real. It wasn't really me in the television.
Yeah.
But I couldn't quite find the words to explain to them how it was that I got there.
Well, kids have a concept of the television. They'll say frequently, "I see you on my TV." And I guess they're kind of surprised sometimes when they find out I'm on a lot of different people's TV.
Yeah, that other people see you as well.
Yeah, because little kids want that personal thing anyway. This is, you know, my TV and my house and my bed and so forth. And so it's out of this concept that we're a bunch of little things inside. Oh, one time, this is a kind of funny story. Apparently, the show started and on TV, and I said, gee, I'm really thirsty. I'd like some juice. And a kid happened to be drinking some orange juice, so he poured it into the VCR. And they had never taken apart and rebuilt.
That's funny. Here's one of the questions that someone asked me yesterday to ask you. How many Caseys have there been? The actual puppet?
Only one.
So, only one?
Yeah. Used to get frequent facelifts. I wish I could. Judith would repaint him. And when he started out, he didn't have the little rosy cheek circles either,
right.
Which I'd completely forgotten until we saw some old pictures. And then she'd replace his hair from time to time as it got worn. But he was the one and only. Oh, his hands used to sometimes have to be replaced maybe a couple of times during the whole run.
Right. Well, that's a pretty durable puppet, though.
Oh, yeah. Now, Finnegan had to be replaced.
Right.
And that was traumatic for me because the original Finnegan had sort of taken on a personality from the shape of Judith's hand.
Right.
And when she had this fluffy, clean new one, it just was not Finnegan. It took me weeks to relate to it. And then eventually the original Finnegan was brought back as Finnegan's brother Flanagan for a while.
Right.
And toward the end of just before Judith retired, the second Finnegan was even more worn than the original was.
Was there ever, when Judith retired, was there ever any discussion on keeping Casey and Finnegan on the show, or was it a difficult decision to actually retire those two characters?
Well, she retired, because they were her creations, there wouldn't be anybody else in the world who could do Casey or Finnegan. It's
right.
Not just a matter of the voice. It was just she herself imbued them with her own particular kind of personality, and they were her property. So it was just understood that whenever she did leave, that they would go with her.
Now, how involved are you? I know that you write some songs for the show. How involved are you in the creative process of the show? Do you sit down with the writers and say,
"Yeah,
this is
the process"? Is that they assigned a certain number of shows each year, each writer, and they submit an outline first. And Susan Sheehan, who's our producer, and I go over the script outlines, and then we meet with the writers and make suggestions for changes or additions or subtractions, whatever. And I don't think we've ever totally, once in a while we totally reject an outline. The writers get kind of tired of doing the same stuff, and we want to be different.
Right.
And there's a limit. You just can't be too different. So.
Well, there are some things that Mr. Dressup probably just wouldn't do.
Yeah, because it's very personal for me, so they sometimes get shot down, but... Susan and I are the script editors, and then when they get into final form and the total new script comes in, the finished script, then we go over that again, and even then there can be a lot of changes. And it's a good thing they all have word processors now. Just go back and punch up the program and just... put in the substitutions or additions.
Yeah, it does make life a lot easier having one of these things.
They used to have to retype everything.
I just bought a computer recently, and it has changed my life. Because I don't know how to use it completely yet. I just know how to do the things that I need it to do for my writing. But it has completely revolutionized the way that I work. It's quite unbelievable,
yeah,
really.
I think for a writer, it's a wonderful tool. I can't even do... I've got one that my wife actually got for the daycare. And she was the one that was learning how to use it. I tried to type letters, and after 2.5 hours, the whole thing exploded and disappeared.
And that's happened to me, and it is possibly the most frustrating thing that can ever happen to you, because you don't know where it goes.
No,
it just disappears, and it's like, oh, I'm never going to see that again, you know?
So that's when I pick up the ballpoint, a clean piece of paper, and write a real letter.
That seems the more Mr. Dress-Up way to do it, though, anyway, I think.
Oh, yeah, well, actually, works best for me.
Now, if you hadn't have been a children's entertainer, if you hadn't have come to Canada to work with Fred Rogers and stayed here, what career path do you think you would have taken?
I don't know. I originally trained to be a commercial artist, but I was pretty far out of that and pretty much into theater and television. So I probably would have stuck to theater. I did a lot of technical work. I was a scene designer, and I scene painted, and I did props and acting in children's theater. So I think I probably would have stuck with something like that. Something in a personal performance kind of thing, even if I might have gotten into advertising art. I certainly would never be an administrator.
How many more years of Mr. Dressup can we look forward to?
That's an interesting question that is asked more and more often these days. I really don't know. I'm having fun now, and I need something to do, and it would be very hard to... Actually, it frightens me to think of if somebody said, okay, this is the end of the show. It's not the income. It's just the not being anymore that would really be hard for me. So I don't want to quit, and CBC is really happy with the show as it is, and as long as I can... remember half of the material, I guess I'll be doing it.
And you have a lovely office there on the 7th floor. I was just there yesterday.
Oh, yeah. That's isn't that funny? Because I've never had an office before, because I just come in once a week for meetings.
Right.
So I have that nice office and the view, and I come in an hour early on meeting day, which is Tuesday, and try to answer all my mail and phone calls, and then I leave it for a week. So if you'd like to rent an office...
do you personally sit down and answer letters from children and parents who write into you?
Yeah, I always... Because we don't get a huge volume of mail, of course, because most of our viewers just don't know how to write.
Can't write.
So the letters that we get, there's enough for me to handle, and I kind of like it. You get a lot of really special kinds of letters, too, which is, you know, you really have to answer personally. And I think, well, I know a lot of people have met me when I was out on tour, and they said, gee, 4 years ago, you answered a, we sent you something, you answered it personally. That was so nice. Well, of course, it isn't that hard to do when you don't have a, an awful lot of correspondence, but people like it, and I like to do it.
Yeah, I don't think that perhaps... that you could realize the resonance it has for someone to receive a letter from someone that they see on television. I know years ago, when I was a kid, I wrote to Mr. Dressup, and I got a little letter back. I got a postcard back with your photograph on the front, mm-hmm. and my name on the back, you know, to Richard from Mr. Dressup, and a little note, and I kept that thing for years and years and years, and I've lost it somewhere in between the move from Nova Scotia to Ontario. I've lost it somewhere, and honestly, I can't tell you how many times I've thought to myself, it's got to be here somewhere, and I've gone and tried to search my apartment for it to see if I could find it, if for some reason I just overlooked it all the other times I've looked for it. And it, but it was really very special to me that someone sort of cared enough to write me back personally.
Oh, that's nice.
Yeah, and I was also the hit of the neighborhood as well, I have to tell
well,
you.
I could send you another one.
Oh, I'd love it. I'd love it.
Yeah, well, the ones we have now are in color, too.
Oh, mine was in black and white.
They don't have Casey and Finnegan on them.
Right. Well, I was the absolute hit of the neighborhood with this thing. just to sort of wrap up here, I know we've sort of gone over time a little bit.
Oh, yeah,
for
I'm a very garrulous interviewer.
Oh, I'm certainly not minding that at all. I don't want to use up your whole morning, though. What is the most gratifying part of being a children's entertainer? I guess during your live shows and with your television show?
Well, probably the answer is the children.
And
I think I mentioned it earlier when I said that I was getting all of this attention. That's really it, because the feedback you get when you find out that, you know, you've affected somebody's life, and we try to hope that it's in a positive way. But, of course, when I do the live show, you can see the audience laughing and having a good time, and that's what every entertainer lives for.
Mm-hmm.
And on the TV show, we all know by now when we do something, if we do something that's really going to go over well, you know, you sort of have a subliminal feeling that, boy, that was a good one. And, you know, you can sort of see the little kids at home laughing and enjoying it. And then the kind of warmth that people have when they when I meet them, you know, I can just imagine what the opposite would be. Somebody that everybody hates.
Yeah, if you were
Rush Limbaugh.
Yeah, or somebody like that.
Yeah.
Now I'm guessing that, do you have nieces and nephews, grandkids?
Yeah.
Do they watch Mr. Dressup, and how do they feel?
Yeah, I was just talking to my youngest grandson. He's not quite 2.5, and he was just about to turn it on at 10:30. My two grandsons are older. They're 10 and 11, 11 and 12 now, and they were by my daughter's husband's previous marriage, so they had watched Mr. Dressup, and then all of a sudden Mr. Dressup became grandpa by marriage. And Caitlin, who's 6, and Liam, of course, have grown up seeing me on television. And with Liam, I guess it was last fall before he suddenly made the connection, because the kids, Caitlin would be watching it, and Liam would go, you know, be running around the room, and apparently one day he looked up and just took sort of a double take and said, Grandpa, what the heck is he doing? And I understand Caitlin had a birthday a while back, a month ago, and I was on tour, so I couldn't be at the birthday party. And she was, or wouldn't be there. So she was telling her mother, well, she was going to, the kids were going to come over to their house, and then they were all going to Grandpa's house. And Kathy said, well, Caitlin, you know, Grandpa isn't going to be home. She says, "That's all right. I want to prove once and for all that my grandpa is Mr. Dressup."
It sounds like something that kids would say in the school ground, you know. My grandfather is Mr. Dressup, you know.
Yeah.
Oh, sure he is.
The youngest grandson, they were talking about television and people on television. They mentioned Mr. Dressup, and he said, "Mr. Dressup, my grandfather." And the teacher said, "Well, yes, of course, everybody would like to have Mr. Dressup as a grandpa." He said, no, he really is. "Well, we know that, and it's fun to pretend that." And I finally had to end up going to the school.
Oh, really?
Well, she realized it after a while, but...
That's funny. One last question. I realize I said that two questions ago, but I wanted to ask you about your Lifetime Achievement Award, the Earl Grey Award. Mm-hmm. That must have been quite a thrill for you.
Oh, it was. Yeah. Probably the biggest, because the program has gotten awards before, but this was just something really special. And I was very moved, and it was nice. The whole family was there for the awards ceremony and the dinner, and we got a lot of beautiful pictures from it. And I really felt an achievement.
Yeah. Well, and you looked when you made the speech, you looked moved.
Oh, I was. I had a bet with our Lois Pearson, our other pianist, that she bet me $5 I'd cry. So I carefully rehearsed all week before that. It was going to be exactly 90 seconds, and I was able to, go through all the emotional things so I'd really have a handle on it. But what happened, you remember the before the award, they had all the old shots in the shows?
Yes.
Fred Rogers and King Friday.
Yeah.
That did it. But as I told Lois, I said, I wasn't crying. My eyes were sweating a little bit when Fred came on. She paid off, actually, but she paid it all in pesos and Danish marks and Caribbean money.
That's funny. Well, thank you so much for this. It's been a real treat to talk to you. It was a real thrill to talk to Mr. Dressup.
Oh,
it really has been.
Yeah, do you want to give me an address? I will send you.
Oh, I'd love to. Yeah, it's 159 Essex Street, which is Essex. Street, and that's Toronto, Ontario, and my postal code is M like Mary, 6 G like Gary, 1 T like Terry, 6.
Okay.
And the last name is Crouse. It's Crouse.
Crouse.
And it's Richard, and there we go. And I'd love to have a replacement for my picture. I'm so excited.
Okay.
Well, thank you very much, and I'll send copies of this article when it comes out to Jan Audi.
Oh, thank
Audi
you.
For you,
yeah,
so you can have a look at them.
Thanks.
Great. Well, thanks for your time.
Okay.
Okay.
All the best.
Thank you. Bye now.
Bye.